All right, all right, all right. Hey, everybody, how are you doing today? I hope you're doing really good. First, to help you understand what we're talking about in Reggie time, we have to go to an assembly program. Every time I start assembly programs, I kind of, if I've never been there before, I start with this. Life, the meaning of life. There are two things in life you must always remember. Number one, always remember this. Boys and girls are different. That's when everybody gets a little crazy. Teachers start looking at me weird, but let me explain. There are four ways boys and girls are different. Number one, I'm making myself laugh and I haven't even started. This is great. Number one, boys and girls are different. If a girl has to go to the bathroom, two girls get to go with her. You ain't never seen a brother go, ooh, I gotta go. Hey, Steve, let's go pee pee. Come on, go ahead, laugh. You're watching this, but laugh because you know I'm right. Number two, a girl sneezes pretty. Catoo, you know good and well, if a brother sneeze, you better run. And a woman cries pretty. Men cry ugly. A brother be like, you know I'm right. Go ahead and clap and just say, all right, all right, all right. Number three, women can drive cars better than men. Women can drive better than men. I know all the boys are hating right now, but let me explain. A woman got a brand new car. Oh, let's wrap this one. A woman got a brand new car. Hey, she really can't drive very far. She forgot to put gas in her car. Now brother gonna steal her car. A woman will wreck her car to save a cat running across the road. A man will wreck his car trying to kill that sucker running across the road. Clap your hands, everybody. You know I'm right. Last one, boys and girls are different. You ever get up in the morning, get your toothpaste and your toothbrush and go to put it in your mouth and the toothpaste falls off? Girls, what do? Wash it out of the sink, get more toothpaste, start over. Boys, what do? Scoop it up. Yeah. Boys and girls are different. Meaning of life. Number two, just say it with me. Everybody say, life is a roller coaster. I love roller coasters. They go so fast, makes my fat go backwards. I'm skinny again. I know that's funny, but you don't understand. When I was little, I rode the fastest roller coaster in the world, 120 miles an hour. Bro, it went so fast, I went blind. My cheeks flew over my head. I couldn't see nothing. The whole ride, I kept hearing this noise. It was like, blah, 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 blah. Then I realized we going so fast, my fat was suffocating the girl sitting behind me. It's not right. When I was in the ninth grade, a freshman, all my friends talked me into getting on a roller coaster that went upside down. Reggie don't belong upside down. I go upside down, people get hurt. Now I know some of y'all are looking at me like, it was not good. I mean, I'm talking, we went down the hill, around the curve, halfway through the loop upside down, the ride broke. The ride broke. It stopped upside down. All my fat is rolling toward my head. I could hear it on the news. Fat man died on roller coaster. Then it got worse. The girl in front of me, she threw up and the wind was blowing in my direction. I can't duck. And if I could duck, my belly button would give me a hickey on my forehead. That ain't good. Some of you are looking at me like, what does that have to do with life? Everything. Some days you're on top of the hill, everything's great. Some days you're going down the hill so fast you want to quit, but never give up on the ride of life because they will fix the ride. The only question is, will you be on the ride when they fix it? So the phrase of the day is never give up. Come on, everybody say never give up. The question we're asking today is this: what kind of person are you? What kind of person do you want to be? Now, I have a simple Bible story for you, and everything that we do in Reggie time, I take normal day life stuff and I connect it with the Word of God. This Bible story is one of my favorite, so let me read it to you. In 1 Kings chapter 9, 1 Kings chapter 17, verse 9, 1 Kings 17, verse 9, the Bible says this. He's talking to a prophet, a man of God, and he said to the prophet, he says, go at once to Zephrah in the region of Sidon and stay there. I have directed a widow there who will supply you with food. Okay, so he told the prophet to go to a certain place. Now, there's something you need to know. There's been no rain for years upon years upon years. There's no water. There's no food. And for him to walk there, he ain't got no food. He ain't got no water. He just has to get there. And God said he's going to provide a lady, a widow. Y'all know what a widow is, right? It's someone who's lost their spouse, a husband who has passed away. So she's probably doing her best with what she's got to make it for her own. But he directed a woman there who will supply you with food. Look at verse 10. So he went to Zephrah. When he came to the town gates, a widow gathering sticks, he called to her and said, would you bring me a little jar of water, please, so I can drink? As she was going to get the water, he called, and bring me, please, a piece of bread. A piece of bread. Now look at verse 12. This is cool. This is one of my favorite. As surely as your Lord God lives, she replied, I do not have any bread, only a handful of flour in a jar and a little oil in a jug. I am gathering sticks to take home to make a meal for myself and my son that we may eat it and die. Did y'all hear that? So that they may eat it and die. So literally she knows this is the end of what she has. The prophet, his name was Elijah, and Elijah heard that. He heard her say, as surely as God lives, I only have a little flour, a little oil. I'm gathering sticks to mix a meal for me and my son to eat and die. So I mean, she's already starving. Her son is already hungry. This is it, the last thing. She held out on that little flour and oil as long as she could, and they're going to eat it and die. He heard her say that, but this guy, Elijah, the prophet, he says, don't be afraid. Go home and do as you said. But first, make me a small loaf of bread and bring it to me so that I can eat. And yourself something for your son after you do that. For this is what the Lord God says. Your jar of flour will not run out and your jug of oil will not go dry until the Lord sends rain. And she went and she did it. I think that's what I want to simply say. She went and she did it. Let me ask you, what kind of person are you? Are you the kind of person that without knowing it, God can set you up to be a miracle for someone else? Are you that kind of person? Are you the kind of person that actually has the faith to believe that God has a plan, even when you're making your last meal and someone asks to give to them, that you would do it and give to them, even if you think it'll be the end of you, but something for them? Would you do that? What kind of person are you? It's what we have to do. But you got to understand, we get to choose. We get to grow. We get to change. We get to become the man or the woman that we want to be. I want to be like this lady. I don't know. I got in my own mind, when I read stories like this, I have her deciding, I'm going to make that man some bread. So she goes home, gets her flour, gets her oil. She starts making this bread. Her son, on his deathbed, starving, starts smelling it. He can smell the bread. He can smell the loaf. He starts getting happy. I'm about to eat. I'm so hungry. And then he comes out and his mom has already made the bread. And he's like, Mama, when are we going to eat? And she says, I'll be back. I have to take this loaf of bread to a stranger. I would beat my mama down. I know it's not right. I know it's wrong. But if I'm about to die and she made bread and she going to take it to a stranger, I'm Mama, what's wrong? You have lost your ever-loving mind. There's no way I'm going to let her do that. But listen to me very carefully. Sometimes God has us do things that other people won't do. Go places other people won't go. Say things other people won't say and act the way that other people aren't. I heard people say this all the time. When everyone else stands, you can sit. When everyone else sits, you can stand. Martin Luther King Jr., he said something that always stuck with me. He said, it's not the voice of my enemy, but it's the silence of my friends that hurt me. I want to be like this lady. I want to be able to step beyond my feelings, beyond my own hunger, beyond my own needs, and do something great for someone else. I want to be that person for Jesus. What about you? What about you? And you know what's great? When she went away and did it, when she came back, her jar of oil never run dry. Her jug never run empty of flour. Everything she needed, she had, because she chose to do what God told her to do. How about you today? How about me? How are we doing this? In the last session, we talked about how that we have to set our mind on what God wants us to do. You know what I love about this story? At the very, very, very beginning of the story, the first thing that was said was this. God told the prophet, go to this place. I have a woman there who's going to take care of you. He didn't say nothing to the woman. She just said something to the prophet. She was just living her life the way she lives, and God knew that he could trust her to do what he needed her to do. Let's live our life the way we live and do it in a way that God can trust us to do what he wants us to do. Let's get set up by God to do something great.